الحمد لله وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد نورك الساري ومردك الجاري واجمعني به في كل أطواري وإياهم وعلينا معهم وفيهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين يا نور. And we ask Allah to send these salutations and prayers along with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his family and companions upon us with them and among all of them. And we ask Allah that by his mercy, and he's the most merciful of the merciful. And we'd like to thank Bayt Muhammad and also the shuyukh and the elders that are present. And I'm a little shy to stand up here while there's elders and shuyukh and talabat ilm in the audience, but imtithalan and following the order and the organization of our hosts, we do so. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminding us of the favor that he's given us, he says subhanahu wa ta'ala, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ كِتَاب نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. Surely to you has come from Allah a light and a radiant book. And Allah says, speaking specifically to that light, and that's, he's from the meaning, Prophet Muhammad is from the meanings of light. In that verse, Allah says, speaking to him specifically, Ya ayyuhan nabi, inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashiran wa nadhira wa da'iyan ilallahi bi'idnihi wa sirajan munira. O Prophet, surely we have sent you as a witness, a bearer of glad tidings, as well as a warner, a summoner to Allah, by Allah's permission, and a radiant lamp. And he said of himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in what Al-Bayhaqi, Ahmad, Hakim, and others narrate from him, Inni indallah lakhatumun nabiyina wa inna adama lamunjadilun fitinati. Surely I was with Allah, the seal of all prophets, while Adam was still cast down in his earth. وَسَأُخْبِرُكُمْ عَنْ ذَلِكَ. And I'll tell you the affair of that. دَعْوَةُ أَبِي إِبْرَهِيمُ. He said, I am the supplication of my father Abraham. وَبِشَارَةُ عِيسَى. And I am the glad tidings of Jesus, عليه السلام. وَرُؤْيَا أُمِّيَ الَّتِي رَأَتْ وَكَذَلِكَ أُمَّهَاتُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَرَيْنَ. And I am the vision of my mother which she saw, and in likewise the mothers of prophets see. وَإِنَّ أُمَّ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ رَأَتْ حِينَ وَضَأَتْهُ نُورًا أَضَاءَ لَهَا قُصُورَ الشَّامِ. And verily, the mother of the Messenger of Allah saw when she gave birth to him a light from which the palaces of the Levant were illumined, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And his uncle Al-Abbas, in the ninth year, returning from the Battle of Tabuk, he took permission to do what we've been engaged in this gathering, and that is to praise Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in poetry, and to mention his origin, and to mention his virtues, and to mention his birth, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to mention his light. He said, O Messenger of Allah, I wish to praise you. Ya Rasulullah, inni uridu an amtadihak. I want to praise you. And the Messenger of Allah commanded him to do so, which makes it sunnah, and also pray and encouraged him. He said, Qul la yafdudillahu faka. He said, may you do so and may Allah preserve your teeth. Meaning, may you speak well and may Allah reward you by that, by you not losing your teeth. So Al-Abbas, he praised Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this light that Allah gifted to the creation sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, saying, وَمِنْ قَبْلِهَا طِبْتَ فِي الدِّلَالِ وَفِي مُسْتَوْدَعٍ حَيْثُ يُخْصَفُ الْوَرَقُ. Prior to this realm, you were pure in the realm of the unseen, as well as the place of safekeeping where fig leaves were worn. Mentioning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, existence in the loins of Adam alayhi salam in paradise. ثُمَّ حَبَطَ الْبِلَادَ لَا بَشَرٌ أَنْتَ وَلَا مُضْغَةٌ وَلَا عَلَقٌ. Then you ascended to the lands, not yet a human, nor a fetus, nor like a clot. بَلْ نُطْفَةٌ تَرْكَبُ السَّفِينَةَ وَقَدْ أَلْجَبَ نَصْرًا وَأَهْلَهُ الْغَرَقُ. But rather you were just a seed, meaning in the loins of Noah, and you boarded the ark while the idols of Noah and its people were drowned by the flood. تُنَقَّلُ مِنْ صَالِبٍ إِلَى رَحِمٍ إِذَا مَضَى عَالَمٌ بَدَى تَبَكُ. Speaking to Rasulullah, saying, you were transmitted from one loins to another womb. When one generation passed, another came, emerged. حَتَّحْتَوَى بَيْتُكَ الْمُهَيْمَنُ مِنْ خِنْدَفِ عَلِيَاءَ تَحْتَهَا النُّتُكُ. Until your guarded house from the lineage of your great-grandmother Khindif, the wife of Ilyas, towered up over all of the lineages of the Arabs, like a summit towers over the ranges of mountains. And then he mentioned this blessed birth that we're commemorating in this month that occurred in the year of the elephant on Monday, prior to dawn on the 12th of Rabi al-Awwal, in the more famous position, a light that emerged and illumined the whole world. And he said, وَأَنْتَ لَمَّا وُلِدْتَ أَشْرَقَتِ الْأَرْضُ وَضَاءَتْ بِنُورِكَ الْأُفُقُ. وَنَحْنُ فِي ذَلِكَ الضِّيَاءِ وَفِي النُّورِ وَسُبْلَ الرَّشَادِ نَخْتَرِكُ. Speaking to his nephew, the beloved messenger of Allah, he said, when you were born, the earth was illumined and the horizon shone with your light. And we are in that light and we are in that radiance and we travel the pathways of guidance. And we ask Allah by that light, Allahumma, بجاه الممدوح عندك والمادح نسألك أن تعظمنا أن تعظم حظنا من ذلك النور والضياء وأن تهدينا سبيل الرشاد. And we ask Allah by the prestige of that one who was praised, that Allah give us a great portion of this light of this last prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And we have to understand the great blessing we have in al-habib sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Allah, as Sidi Amir referenced, he gifted knowledge of himself to this creation. Allah loved to be known, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he created this creation, and by him, he was known. And the first one to be created was the reality, that light of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And that one, and Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was the first one to know his creator and to reflect, as the creation does, the names and attributes of the creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then drew the rest of the creation from that reality and planted that reality in Adam, transmitted that reality through all the way to his mother Amina, and that reality sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam that would point most to the one, that would point most to Ar-Rahman, to the most merciful, that would point most to Ar-Rahim, the compassionate, that would point most to Al-Ghafoor, to the one who is forgiving, any of Allah's beautiful attributes and names, that reality that first knew him, that was this gift to his creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this messenger to the creation. By knowing this messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we would know his creator. That reality reached Amina and emerged into the world in the likes of this month, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So he is Allah's slave in every station. He is Allah's messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to all of the creation. Anyone who knows Allah in these British islands, or in our land of North America, or in anywhere in the world, after the advent and the emergence of this Habib Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, anyone who knows Allah will know him through a Nabi Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Each of us has a longing in our fitrah, our primordial nature, to know the divine subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a thirst that is not quenched by other than knowledge and love of and for and from the divine, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And anyone who's a seeker, the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one who will point him to that one he seeks, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no parting from that. In all of Allah's names, in all of Allah's attributes, he's the one who guides us to that. Prophecy is the station that receives Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's manifestation of himself to his creation and transmits it in a manner in which it can be understood and then articulated and known. How would we know the divine without being informed by those who the divine had revealed himself to, subhanahu wa ta'ala? We wouldn't know Allah. We wouldn't know paradise. We wouldn't know hellfire, except that we know it on the tongues of prophets. They're a unique beings, and prophecy is a station that no one attains by virtue of their own merit or by virtue of their own work. It's a gift that's gifted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the creation, and Allah gifted you, Ummah of Muhammad, to be the community of the greatest of his messengers, of the culmination of his messengers, of the seal of all his messengers. That revelation which came and capped and sealed prophecy, that is your Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Any meanings that are to be known about Allah by those who are mukallaf, those who are accountable on the surface of this earth, not just from the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam until the end of time, from the time of Adam alayhi salam to the end of time, those meanings can be known from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was revealed on Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From the great arifin, some of them say, and we know that, and you are a talibat ilm, we know with the coming of his reception of the Quran, there was naskh, there was abrogation of the previous sharia, of the previous laws of the other prophets. Even obviously there was an abrogation of their prophecy. We believe in all of them, but there was abrogation of their laws. Some of the arifin said, no, it wasn't an abrogation of a sharia with the sharia. It was an abrogation of a ruling with the new ruling, meaning that all of those messengers, they merely articulated the sharia of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that one divine revealed law to all of humanity. And this Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he came and sealed all of that, culminated all of that. No one had a birth like this Habib sallallahu alayhi wasallam. No one had a childhood like this Habib sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He had angelic heart surgery, his heart removed, staring at it before him. The portion of his mercy towards the shaitan that he called hadd al-shaitan, that cast out of his heart. Sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Angels participating in his care, the moon being played with by his blessed finger, sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, and he grew up as As-Sadiq al-Amin, and lived in those years of Mecca, sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, until we reached, as was discussed, his 25th year when he married Sayyidatina Khadija, and then his 35th year when the Kaaba was rebuilt, and with his blessed hands, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the black stone was replaced in the Kaaba by those blessed hands of Al-Habib, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The scholars of Sirah mention that when he reached his 38th year, he began to love seclusion, and he would seclude himself in a cave called Hira, that's in a mountain called Jabal al-Nur, the mountain of light, in the cave of Hira, for lengthy periods of time. And he would yatahannath. From its meanings is yata'abbad. He would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From also its meanings is yatahannath, that he was on the religion of the Hanifs, of those who were inclining to the truth. And as Sheikh Ibrahim mentioned, inclining away from falsehood, away from other ways of belief, away from those who do not follow prophecy, away from those who prefer the world to the hereafter, away from those who are idolaters, away from those who are drinkers, away from those who are fornicators, sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And they mentioned that this was from the meanings of his removing himself from Mecca. And why else would someone in seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove themselves from the most noble place that Allah would be worshipped on the surface of this earth in that time, right at the Kaaba? But he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he removed himself from the falsehood of those idol worshippers and the idols that they had surrounded the Kaaba with, and the various types of corruption that they were engaged in, and dedicated himself, yatahannath, solely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the cave of Hira. From his worship there, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was that he would feed the poor. And that's by its nature, prophecy is close to the poor. And brothers and sisters here, those of us in these Western countries, we have to rethink this question. He removed himself from the nonsense of that society, dedicated himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, still remaining close to the poor and the needy. So from his worship, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was that he would feed them. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barak alayhi wa ala. He would spend lengthy nights there and then return to Sayyidatina Khadija and take provisions and return for another stay. Some of the scholars mention that he would, they would meet at a midpoint and he might spend the night there and then return. And there's a masjid that was marked that place where that he would return and meet Sayyidatina Khadija. During this time, he begins to experience additional manifestations of the unseen. And the learned mention that in this phase, he was experiencing things that resemble, and we'll say resemble because we won't compare anyone's station to his, that the awliya and their karamat, they begin to experience miracles. The saints, the friends of God, begin to experience miracles. The end of the affair of the awliya is the beginning of the affair of prophets. So in the beginning of his affair, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, this is prior to the angel Gabriel coming to him, he begins to hear angelic voices, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He begins, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to see light. He begins to hear inanimate objects speak to him. So he said, verily I know a stone that used to greet me prior to my being sent, and this is in the Sahih, and surely I know it until this day. A stone in Mecca would greet him, and he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after receiving revelation, I still know this very stone. Some of them say it was the black stone. He also, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he might walk in the precinct surrounding Mecca during this phase, and a rock or a stone would greet him and say, assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah, and he would turn and there would only be a stone there or a tree there, sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if rocks and stones and animals and celestial bodies, heavenly bodies and terrestrial objects recognize your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do we have hearts that are harder than stones that don't say, assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah, salatu wa salamu alayka ya Habibullah. So he worships in this time. All of this is preceding his receiving the revelation sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And understand, brothers and sisters, that the human being has various levels of his consciousness or experience or hers or aptitudes. So they say, for instance, there's a degree of iman, of faith, right? Belief. And that is like ilm yaqeen, that you're certain of this thing, but you haven't experienced it, right? And that, you can reach that by knowledge that is attained by your eyes and ears, right? You observe things that direct you to faith. You hear things that direct you to faith. You hear accounts about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You have iman in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Above that, our maratib, our levels of wilaya, of sainthood, of being those brought near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those are the saints, right? The highest of them is siddiqeen, and they experience their knowledge of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the unseen, not by their eyes or ears, not by their aql. It's not something that they observe and rationally arrive at a conclusion. It's something they experience by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opening up the eye of their heart, their basira. Those in this station of iman, they learn by their eyes and their ears. Those in the stations of wilaya, and above them are the stations of prophecy, they learn by the eye of their heart. They learn from within. Allah inspires their heart with that knowledge, and then above that are the stations of prophecy. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam secluded himself, removed himself from all of that idolatry and that corruption and that transgression, that we could call it substance abuse, and they abused alcohol, indecency sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and dedicated himself to his Lord. And these things of the unseen in higher degrees began to be revealed to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And brothers and sisters, you and I are his ummah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to follow the way of Abraham a hanif. And attabi'u millata Ibrahim hanifa, to follow all of you the way of Ibrahim a hanif, someone who inclined to the truth and adhered to it. It means ma'il, and that's why Sheikh Ibrahim was translating deviate, someone who swerves from the way of falsehood and is disinclined to it, who secludes him or himself away from the idolatry of the society in which they live, away from the tyranny of the society in which they live, away from the indecency of the society in which they live, and dedicates themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam engaged in this for lengthy periods of time, and Allah opened to him the unseen. Brothers and sisters, if we want to be opened in a deeper meaning, not just a meaning of aql, not just a meaning of iman, a meaning of dhawq, of tasting the message of this Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of being of those who transmit the message of this Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the people of our age, we have to emulate him in that quality of cutting ourselves off from this falsehood. Brothers and sisters, have some khalwa with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Maybe that'll be in a corner of your home. Maybe that will be in a retreat that you attend, like those retreats that were mentioned. Maybe that will be in i'tikaf with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Ramadan in the masajid. Maybe that will be by going in the wilderness as your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did, and as many prophets did, and many of the awliya. Brothers and sisters, we have to have time where we dedicate ourselves solely to Allah, where we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala solely, and remember that even in that station, he wasn't cut off from the needy of his time, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. If we hope to ascend to higher meanings of iman, and as we connect to this Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he is the only one that will lead us to that which is our heart's ultimate desire and greatest bliss, and that is to know his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of the pathways to Allah are blocked, as Sayyidina Junaid said, except for the one who traces the footsteps of the messenger. And then he, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, has a distinction among all of the messengers of being the seal. And it's mentioned by the ulama, a meaning that is sound, even if the tradition has an issue with its chain, that the Prophet, that the scholars of the community of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam resemble the prophets of Banu Israel. Right? And none of the awliya ever ascend to the station of prophecy. That's something that's gifted and willed by Allah. However, the awliya of the ummah of al-Habib sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, the kummal of his waratha, the elect of his waraka, those in that station of haq yaqeen, those whose inner sight, the eyes of their heart, their basair, are observing meanings of this Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of a meanings of the revelation that came to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of meanings of divine inspiration, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or it's attributed to him and the ulama of his time, that they are like the prophets of Banu Israel. The prophets of Banu Israel would revive the meanings of the religion for the people of Banu Israel. And he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that at each 100 years Allah has sent for this community those who will revive for them the affair of their religion. He said sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, there will, and this is in the Sahihain, there will continue to be from my community a group, dhahirina ala al-haq, he said, giving aid to the truth. Or another meaning is dhahirina, that they are well aware of the truth, not harmed by any of those who oppose them until Allah's command comes. So brothers and sisters, he came to us as that messenger, that reflection of, that slave of Allah in every station, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Everything about his life speaks to that. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, secluded himself in that cave of Hira until the revelation that will begin the next virtues with came to him. And then in those 23 years, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 23 years, went from Arabia being a place of idolatry and drinking and indecency and crime and bandits to stabilizing all of Arabia under Tawheed, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The things he articulated, he did, or he witnessed. And imagine this, the Quran will be the basis by which humanity is judged on Yawm al-Qiyamah, and ultimate salvation or damnation, and the fruits of that forever will be reaped on the basis of that Sharia. And what is that Sharia? That is what this man sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, did, or accepted in his life. لا ما ينطق عن الهوى إن هو إلا وحي يوحى. He did not speak from his own desire, it was only revelation revealed. But brothers and sisters, there are meanings about Allah Jalla Jalala wa Ta'ala fi'ula, that your heart and my heart, your soul and my soul, your sir and my sir, they long for, brothers and sisters. It's our aspiration and always has been from the day of Elastu bi Rabbikum, when Allah made himself known to you and I, subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are meanings that our hearts long for about this Lord of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We cannot attain them without a connection to Allah Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Anyone who tells you other than that is a liar. In every station, he's the guide sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. As a poet said, As-sayru ilmun wal-ukulu adillatun wal-rabbu kastun wal-rasulu imamu. The journey is knowledge. People of reason are guides. The Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala is the objective, and the messenger is the imam. He is the imam to that Lord who is our objective. We cannot know this Lord except by revelation, brothers and sisters. Revelation. Al-Imam al-Ghazali talks about knowledge, revealed knowledge or shar'i knowledge. It is what is gained from prophets. Mastufida min al-anbiya. It's not figured out by some human. It is what is gained by prophets. People who experience God and articulated to us the speech of God subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is sacred knowledge. What's gained by prophets. What's gained from prophets, and it is not arrived at by the figuring of one's intellect, like mathematics, nor by experimentation, like medicine, or we could say the sciences, nor is it transmitted on the tongues as is language. Prophecy is the only means to attain this sacred knowledge, and brothers and sisters, we cannot connect to prophecy without a sanad to nubuwwah. You cannot reach revealed knowledge without a sanad to prophecy. They can't make it up in Cambridge, they can't make it up in Oxford, they can't make it up in Yale or Princeton or wherever, in Berkeley, in UC Berkeley, where I'm born from. That none of those people will lead you to these meanings that your heart and my heart long for and thirsts for about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except the prophets. And no one connects us to the prophets except their heirs, as Abdullah bin al-Mubarak said, Al-Isnadu min ad-Din walau sha'a lawla isnad laqala man sha'a ma sha'a. Connecting through a chain to prophecy is from this religion. If it were not for that, whoever wanted would say whatever they want. And as your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, revivers from his community remain on the surface of this earth. As he said, there's a ta'ifa from this community, clearly aware of the truth, not harmed by those who oppose them until the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes. This way of wilaya, which is the only way to truly connect to nubuwa, this way of sainthood, of the friendship of Allah, which is the only way to connect in reality to the higher meanings of nubuwa, and those who come close to experiencing what nubuwa is and who receive the articulations of nubuwa and articulate them to us, we can seek them out, brothers and sisters. They are the ones in this time of confusion that are not confused. They are the ones that are clear, well aware of the truth. They are the ones that, as it's been referenced, during the times of great trials at the end of times, they are the ones who will recognize the Mahdi. They are the ones who will give bay'ah to him. They are the ones that will be his ministrators, his ministers. Those are the ones during the time of the Dajjal that will be fed by dhikr. They're the ones that are not deluded by any of these trials. So brothers and sisters, if that is the case in the Ummah of Nabi Muhammad, we must seek out the heirs of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we hope to know Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Lord of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to continue to bless these institutions in this blessed land, like Greensville Trust and like Bait Muhammad and all of the Talabat Ilm from the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that continue to translate this Quran that was revealed by Allah on the heart of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, articulated on his blessed tongue, radiated in his blessed face, demonstrated in his beautiful actions, reflected in his light sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. By connecting him is the only way we can know Allah, brothers and sisters. Proceeding behind him is our only path to salvation, brothers and sisters. And we must connect the youth to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if we're going to connect them to him, we must connect them to these teachers. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the blessing of this light and this Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was sent in the likes of this month, that Allah give us a great portion of that light of that Habib sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, and that Allah grant us to see him in this life and at the time of death and in the barzakh and the hereafter in khair and lutf and afiyah, that Allah give us a great portion of his inheritance and emulating him sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And brothers and sisters, from the first of things that are going to cut you off from him or me off from him, well, the adab Allah ta'ala that would be other than the way of the hanif, is for us to deviate from him in belief sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, or for us to deviate from him in practice sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Don't surrender your belief for the hearts of your children or their minds or their belief over to some disbeliever, waliyadu billah ta'ala, someone who doesn't even believe in the existence of Allah or of a Nabi Muhammad or the Sharia of a Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we risk by that being cut off from him eternally, waliyadu billah ta'ala. Don't surrender your eyes or your ears or your heart or your tongue or your hands or your feet or your stomach or your private areas. Don't surrender them over to the nafs. Don't surrender them over to the shaitan and allow the ego and the shaitan to lead you away from the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This disobedience, that's an opposition to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's going to be one of the greatest veils that would come between you or I and following this Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we claim to really want his Lord, we can only follow him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So as Shaykh Ibrahim mentioned, we have to make him the governor of our eyes sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have to make a Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the governor of our ears sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have to make a Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the governor of our tongues sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And as he said, the one who travels that way, first in obligations, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam governs the obligations of my body and my prayer and my beliefs and my dealings with my family and my dealings with others and the creatures. And then the person continues to aspire to be close to Allah, to be beloved to Allah. Right? وَلَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلْ حَتَّى أُحِبَّ. My servant continues to draw nearer to me by voluntary works until I love him, Allah says in that hadith Qudsi. What voluntary works are there? They're the works of a Nabi Muhammad, so that he can be beloved to Allah like Habibullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So what is the fruit of the follower of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam? Allah says on the tongue of who? Al-Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, narrated to us by the likes of Imam al-Bukhari, فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُ فَكُنْتُ سَمَعُهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِي. When I love this Muhammadan servant, I am the hearing with which he or she hears. Allah says, I am their hearing. There's a tajalli, there's a theophany on this creation, on this creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this follower of Muhammad, such that he or she is in a station resembling the station of our forefather Adam. Later, our station of our Prophet Muhammad, he's in a station of khilafah. Allah says, I am his hearing, I am his sight, I am his hand, I am his foot. If this servant asks, I will grant him. If this servant seeks refuge, I will give him or her refuge. I am not disinclined to do anything that I have willed, like taking the soul of this servant. The servant hates death, and I dislike to hurt him or her. This Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this servant has approached, has become so close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so grounded in their knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah calls himself their hearing, their sight, so surrendered in will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah's will almost conforms to their will. It's like they're on paradise on earth. How did the servant reach the station of ma'rifah? By following one man, and Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. We ask you, O Allah, and you are the most merciful of the merciful, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. Do not allow any of us to be severed from this Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Make all of our hearts bonded with this Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Grant us to follow him with our eyes and our ears and all of our organs. Grant us to pray like him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Give charity like him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Be close and merciful to the poor and the needy like him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Be gentle and tender to our wives and children like him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Taste the sweetness of prayer like him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Be good to our neighbors and all of the members of our society like him. And we ask you, O Allah, by your mercy, and you're the most merciful of the merciful, Ya Arhamar Rahimin, Ya Arhamar Rahimin, Ya Arhamar Rahimin, grant us to reflect his light and do as he said, Balighu anni walau aya, Ya Allah. Transmit from me even if just one verse, Ya Allah. Grant us to be the people who transmit the verses of your book, Ya Allah, as they were transmitted on the tongue of your Prophet Muhammad to the creation, Ya Allah. Make us close to the revivers of our age and the awliya of our age, from the ministers of the awliya of our age, and take us into your wilaya and grant us your love and his love and their love. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi wa sallam, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, please excuse me.